In the decades 2004 to 2012-13, the average annual economic growth of our economy was a healthy 7.93%. Of this 10-year period, we have a block of 5 years from 2008-09 to 2012-13, when the world economic growth was extremely sluggish, fragile, and uncertain. Though our GDP growth in 2012-13 is at 5%, is the lowest in 10 years, it is much higher than the G7 countries. International projections point out that our growth will continue to be better than these major economies in the next 2 years. I am pointing out these figures not only to have laurels and pat our back. These are areas of concern, but at the same time, my intention is just to convey this evening there is an area of concern, but no room for despondency. We had adopted a globalization strategy to usher in speedy growth. Towards this paradigm, we have progressively liberalized our trade and investment sectors. The international trade to GDP ratio of India at 44% signifies the depth of our country's economy with the world economy. It is therefore hard to expect India's economy to remain immune from the repercussions of a prolonged global financial crisis. The immediate challenges before us is to reverse the deceleration in growth. It is possible for us to re-enter the 7 to 8% GDP growth per year in the next 2 to 3 years. But for that, we must revitalize investments in the country. The high economic growth after 2004-3-4 was led by a spurt in investments. But from 2007-08, the investment rate has continued to decline. Tight monetary policy to contain inflation, lack of adequate procedural flexibility for projects, and reduction in export demand due to global slowdown has affected private sector investment in India. Strengthening the positive investment climate would require us to improve governance of business projects. As per an international survey, India does well in parameters like getting credit and protecting investors. But in other important sectors, such as starting a business, dealing with construction permits, paying taxes, and enforcing contracts, we lag behind many of our competitors. We must make our systems more responsive to the industry's need for facilitation and timely clearances. It is gratifying to note that a Cabinet Committee on Investment has been constituted to monitor and review major projects in respect of various licenses and approvals for their time-bound implementation. A large amount of financial savings in our country are absorbed in meeting governance deficits. Deficits should be brought down so that greater proportion of savings is available for investment. Steps for fiscal consolidation should make it possible to reduce the fiscal deficit progressively to its target of 3% of GDP by 2016-17. Ladies and gentlemen, we must be realistic in our assessment of India's economic prospects. The downbeat atmosphere seen these days is unwarranted. Foreign investors are positive about our economy. The net inflow from foreign institutional investors at rupees 1.6 lakh crores in 2012 is a substantial rise from rupees 39,000 crores in 2011. According to an important survey, India is the third most preferred destination for foreign direct investment after China and US. Between April 2012 and January 2013, over rupees 1 lakh crore have come to our economy as FDI. Our infrastructure sector has great potential to make productive use of these investments. The sectors with high linkage to infrastructure, such as automobile, steel and cement, enjoy high growth in India as compared to many of our competitors. A recovery in the advanced economies is expected in 2014, as their economic growth is projected to increase from 1.4% in 2013 to 2.2% in 2014. We should leverage this growth quickly by enhancing the competitiveness of the domestic industry, especially our export enterprises. Ladies and gentlemen, manpower and technology are the prime drivers of the industrial progress. Abundant manpower underlines India's comparative advantage. By 2025, two-thirds Indians will be in the working age group. By that time, 100 million additional jobs will be required for creation in the manufacturing sector alone. To develop our manpower as partners of progress, all-round efforts are necessary. Greater number of technical institutes is required to be set up. Existing technical institutes that lag behind in quality must be upgraded. More initiatives like the Vocational Training Improvement Project that envisaged upgradation of 400 industrial training institutes are necessary. I am happy to note that All India Management Association, in its continuing efforts at manpower development, has set up a center for skill development and training. The pool of management professionals in our country is not sufficient to meet the demand for such personnel. In 2011-12, the enrollment to commerce and management streams in the country was 34 lakhs. This has to rise for that more institutes for management education is necessary. It is gratifying to note that 7 new Indian institutes of management were set up during the 11th plan period. The private sector can also play a pivotal role and mark their presence as a major producer of managerial manpower. Technology will determine our domestic industry's ability to beat competition. Our research and innovation efforts must aim at technology upgradation to simplify production processes, improve quality, and seek efficiency gains. The industry must partner with the academic and research institutions to develop solutions of wide utility for the market and the common man. We have to do much more to be at the forefront of innovation. Only 1 in 50 patent applications in the world is filed in India. Our patent regime has the difficult task to sustain encouragement to innovation on the one hand, and to maintain the market competition and ensure accessibility and affordability on the other hand. In the words of late Peter Drucker, the renowned management thinker, I quote, "Innovation is the specific instrument of entrepreneurship, the act that endows resources with a new capacity to create wealth," unquote. There are several grassroots innovations that has the potential for development into marketable products. Our industry should support such micro-initiatives so that the benefits of the new and better products accrue to the society. Ladies and gentlemen, our country needs visionary business leaders to manage India's transition to a knowledge economy. We also require the Indian industry to act as a catalyst for deepening our growth process. Our industry should aim at inclusion of all as participants in the economic development. I have an unshakable faith in our economy's bright future. The witness of Managing India Awards exemplify this conviction. Once again, I congratulate all of them for contributing to the country's progress. I am sure they will ignite the minds of other managers and entrepreneurs to think big towards nation building. I also wish the All India Management Association all success in their endeavor. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Jai Hind.